أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما، يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك، يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك، يا أرحم الراحمين. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Alhamdulillah, today we are doing Babun fil Mujahada, a very important chapter, especially because of the unique times that we find ourselves in. Alhamdulillah, is that we are basically just surrounded by, you know, our own temptations, our own desires, our own battles. And Babun fil Mujahada, the chapter regarding Mujahada, regarding striving, regarding struggling, regarding making an effort. This is a very, very important chapter for us, especially in the time that we are in now. Alhamdulillah. So without any further delays, we'll begin. Students, hope you have your books ready. Inshallah. We're going to attempt to complete the chapter today. So I won't do long explanations on each of the ahadith, just give you an overview, and we'll attempt to complete the chapter because it's our last chapter for the term. Alhamdulillah. Okay. So we start with the verses. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ankabut, right at the end, Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا, and those who جَاهَدُوا, those who strive, فِينَا, towards us, those who struggle, but they are struggling in their effort and in their path to come towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to walk that path that is ultimately going to lead them to their salvation, that's going to lead them to Jannah. Those people who painstakingly take those steps, even if it's difficult, even if they have to push themselves to get up. Allah says, Allah promises, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ, definitely, surely, double emphasis, definitely, surely, we will guide them. And it's a present tense verb. We will continuously guide them. We will always be there to hold them by the hand. We will guide them subulana, to our ways. Subul is the plural of the word sabil. Sabil means one path. Subul, many paths. So we will take them, we will guide them, we will show them, we will indicate to them our ways. We will indicate to them how they can actually get onto that highway that leads all the way to Jannah. So as long as we continue to try, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never asks us to be perfect. Allah knows we're going to slip, we're going to struggle, we're going to err. Allah knows that we're going to give in to our lower selves from time to time, or even, you know, often. And Allah says, when we do try though, when we take those steps, Allah will definitely surely guide us to His path. Subhanallah. Wa inna Allah, and indeed Allah, la, definitely, ma'al muhsinin, definitely He is with al muhsinin, those who excel, those who do their best, those who try to always put their best foot forward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises that He is with those who are al muhsinin, and may Allah make us amongst them. Ameen. Next verse, Surah Hijr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa'bud rabbaka, and wa'bud, make ibadah, you know, worship, declare your servitude to rabbaka, to your Rabb, to your Lord. Worship your Lord, devote yourself to your Rabb, hatta, until ya'tiyaka, until comes to you, until what comes to you? Until yaqeen comes to you. Yaqeen means what? It means that which is certain, right? That which there is absolutely no doubt regarding it. And here the Mufassirun say that the word yaqeen refers to death. So worship your Rabb, declare your devotion to your Rabb and show it until death comes to you. Subhanallah, death is, well, in life, death is the only thing that is certain. So continue to strive, continue to worship your Rabb until death comes to you. In other words, don't let your death find you in any other state other than you being in the active worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse indicates the continuous mujahada that it takes to walk this path, to never give up, to never, you know, give this up for something else, to never sell your deen for a temporary pleasure or for a temporary gain. Next verse, Surah Muzammil, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ, and mention the name of your Lord. Mention or remember, both are fine for ذَكَرَ يَذْكُرُ, and remember or mention the name of your Rabb, the name Allah, the name that is filled with barakah. As Allah says, تَبَارَكَ اسْمُ رَبِّكَ, the name of your Rabb is Tabarak. It is filled with barakah. Just saying Allah, Allah. That's why saying Bismillah, it's so beautiful. Small little actions, but filled with so much barakah. And remember or mention the name of your Rabb. وَتَبَتَّلْ إِلَيْهِ تَبْتِيلًا, and devote yourself to him. تَبَتَّلْ, it's an amr. Devote yourself to him. تَبْتِيلًا, wholeheartedly, with all that you have. Subhanallah. And this wadhkur isma rabbika is such a simple thing to do. Even if you're not physically mentioning the name of Allah on your tongue, to feel it in your heart, even in your times of leisure, in your times of happiness. Remember, happiness is a test as well as is a calamity. Even in those times, we still need to mention our Rabb. We fail the test of happiness and of pleasure when we don't mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our heart or with our tongues. And Allah says here, do the simple act that is filled with so much beauty. Mention the name of your Rabb and devote yourself to him wholeheartedly. What does that mean? That means that you basically, well, tabattul means to cut yourself off from the world and to devote yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, this verse doesn't mean that you can't live a life and you can't, you can't enjoy the pleasures of this dunya at all. You know, in fact, Islam is all about balance, and Islam actually doesn't, propagate this way of living where you give up all of your shahawat, which is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married. You know, he enjoyed himself. He did many things, that a normal human being enjoys of this dunya, in addition to his lofty role, subhanAllah. So here Allah says, mention the name of your Rabb, and as much as you can, devote yourself to him wholeheartedly, where it means that you have to give up certain things that is harming your soul. That is your way of devoting yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We go further. Allah says in Surah Zalzala, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ, whoever does mithqal, the weight of a dharra, of an atom, of khayran, of goodness, whoever does just an atom's weight of goodness, yarahu, he will see it. He will see it. That atom's weight of goodness will come back and it will benefit him in some way, in his life or in the akhirah, and in both, subhanAllah. That small little act you do, smiling when you really feel irritated with someone, picking up something even when you don't want to, being kind to your child even when they're pushing your last button, all of those acts that we don't even think anything of, those tiny acts of goodness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises that we will see that. We will see the fruits of those acts. Ameen. Next verse, Surah Muzammil, وَمَا تُقَدِّمُوا لِأَنفُسِكُمْ, and whatever you send forth for yourself, whatever you send ahead for yourselves, min khayrin, of any goodness, min khayrin, it's indefinite, any form of goodness, whatever it is that you had sent ahead for yourself of goodness, tajiduhu inda Allah, you will find it with Allah. Subhanallah. Huwa khayran, he, Allah, is best, wa a'zama, and the greatest, ajra, in reward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala waits to reward us. And the last verse, before we get to the ahadith, Allah says in Surah Baqarah, وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ, and whatever you spend, تُنْفِقُوا like nafaqa, whatever you spend, مِنْ خَيْرٍ, of any goodness, again, it's indefinite, it could be any single thing, money, time, skills, something that you struggled with, but you still did that good thing. Whatever you spend of goodness, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ, so indeed Allah, bihi, regarding it, Allah is what? Alim. Allah is all-knowing. Allah knows, Allah sees, Allah appreciates, Allah recognizes. Even when we do good things and we believe that no one else is appreciating us, no one else acknowledges our efforts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala corrects us and he reminds us that he sees everything. Subhanallah. إِنَّ هَذَا كَانَ لَكُمْ جَزَاءً وَكَانَ سَعْيُكُمْ مَشْكُورًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Insan that your efforts, your strivings, they are mashkur, they are appreciated by Allah, they are seen. So don't fret, don't give up. Alhamdulillah, you know, we are doing this for the purpose, for the cause, and we must continue to hold our heads up high and to take our place in this dunya as vice students of Allah, as khalifa, as khulafa of Allah. Okay, and we start with hadith number one. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Okay. عن أبي هريرة أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه narrates, he says, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إن الله تعالى قال, indeed Allah تعالى said. This makes it a hadith قدسي, right? Indeed Allah تعالى himself said, من عادى لي وليا, من, whoever, عَادَى, whoever shows enmity, whoever opposes, li waliyan, we'll translate the word waliyan first, a friend, right? Whoever opposes, whoever shows enmity to a wali, to a friend, li of mine. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, just to paraphrase there, whoever shows enmity to a friend of mine, to a wali of mine, faqad, so indeed, آذنتُهُ, I declare upon him بالحرب, war. Subhanallah. Whoever shows enmity to a wali of mine, to a friend of mine, so indeed I declare war on him, on that person. Subhanallah. We'll discuss after the hadith, we'll just do a few points on each hadith. We carry on. وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ, and does not draw close, does not draw near, إِلَيَّ, to me. And we're looking for the fa'il. Who does not draw close to me? The fa'il is عَبْدِي. My slave does not draw close to me. بِشَيْءٍ, with anything. أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ, more beloved to me. مِمَّا, than that which iftaraddu alayh, than that which iftaraddu, if you look at the root letters, you'll see fard, compulsory, than that which I have made compulsory alayhi, upon him. So the first point in the hadith, whoever shows enmity to a wali of mine, I declare war on that person. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and your slave, sorry, my slave does not draw close to me with anything that is more beloved to me than that which I have made compulsory upon him. So that's the first step, in other words, towards walking to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure, is to do those things that Allah has made obligatory upon us. Once we've got that covered, once we've got the basics, the foundation is set, the foundation is unshakable, right? You've got your salahs intact, you make your five salahs every day, you make your fajr on time, all your other salahs on time. You know, you start with that foundation. Once that is there, the hadith says now, وَمَا يَزَالُ, مَا يَزَالُ, and continues, where's the ism of ma yazalu? It's the word abdi. My slave continues yataqarrabu ilayya, to draw close to me, bin nawafili, with nawafil, like nafil, with voluntary actions. So he's got all of the basics in order, all of the fara'id, the compulsory actions are in order. The journey doesn't just stop there. The journey goes further, because as the journey continues, it only increases in sweetness. So now once the basics are down, the slave continues to draw close to Allah with the nawafil, with the voluntary acts. And it says, hatta uhibbahu, until or such that I love him. Subhanallah. To guarantee Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love, this is one of the formulas mentioned in this hadith, Qudsi over here. Get your fara'id in order, and once that is there, the journey doesn't end. The journey continues to try and get in your sunan, to try and get your Qur'an recitation in, to try and add in some du'as, some extra recitation of Qur'an. until I love him. فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ and when, so when I love him, when this hub is secured from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the slave, and then what? كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ, I become, this is Allah speaking, remember, I become سَمْعَهُ, his hearing, الَّذِي, which, يَسْمَعُ بِهِ, which he hears with it, وَبَصَرَهُ, and his sight, الَّذِي, which, يُبْصِرُ بِهِ, which he sees with it, وَيَدَهُ, and his hand, الَّتِي, which, يَبْطِشُ بِهَا, which he grasps with it, وَرِجْلَهُ, and his feet, الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا, الَّتِي, which, يَمْشِي بِهَا, he walks with it, وَإِنْ سَأَلَنِي, and if he asks me, أَعْطَيْتُهُ, I will give him, وَلَئِنِ اسْتَعَاذَنِي, and definitely if اسْتَعَاذَنِي, if he seeks refuge in me, if he seeks protection in me, لَأُعِيذَنَّهُ, definitely, surely, I will protect him, I will grant him refuge. Subhanallah. Just a few things to note in here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firstly describes the beauty of being a wali of Allah. And we know Allah says, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْسَنُونَ. Indeed, the friends of Allah, those who are close, there's no fear upon them and they do not grieve, they do not become saddened. But also what I wanted to mention is the fact that we don't know who a wali of Allah actually is. We don't know which person has that station, has that maqam in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes. So for us to actually mistreat anyone, it's actually a gamble that we take, because that person could be a wali. And by you even harming a wali, by hurting his feelings or anything like that, you could actually be causing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to declare war upon you. So be very, very careful how you treat people. And any person can be a wali. Don't be fooled by the external. Don't be fooled by what you see on the outside. Because that person may have such a high rank in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's esteem. And then if we go and we treat that person terribly, we are actually incurring Allah's wrath upon ourselves. May Allah protect us from that. Ameen. And then we also see how the wali of Allah, he is the one who makes that extra effort. You know, if you have a close friend, it takes work, it takes commitment, you know, it takes a certain type of effort from both of you, subhanAllah, just to keep in communication, to make an effort to keep that relationship alive. And that's exactly what Allah says, is that the more you do, the more you invest in that relationship with Him, the closer to Allah you actually become. Such that if you just ask, Allah will give. And if you just seek Allah's protection, He will be there to protect you immediately, subhanAllah. And may Allah grant us to reach this rank. Ameen. And obviously this hadith is metaphorical. We're not saying that this literally happens and that Allah literally becomes the eyes that a person sees with. The entire hadith, that part of it is metaphorical. It's a metaphor for the assistance of Allah. That person walks with the guidance of Allah, with the assistance of Allah, with that insight of Allah. He sees with that insight. And we make dua that Allah blesses us with this. Ameen. Ya Rabbal Alameen. We move to hadith number 2. عن أنس رضي الله عنه أنس رضي الله عنه narrates عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما يرويه regarding that which he narrates it عن ربه from his رب عز وجل. So again it's a hadith Qudsi. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is narrating from that which Allah سبحانه وتعالى himself said. And the hadith goes, إِذَا تَقَرَّبَ الْعَبْدُ إِلَيَّ إِذَا when تَقَرَّبَ when draws near to me. Sorry, not the to me part didn't come yet. إِذَا تَقَرَّبَ when draws near, the fa'il is al-abdu, when the slave draws near, إِلَيَّ to me, شِبْرًا by the measure of a hand span. So if the slave comes close to Allah by the measure of a hand span, right, then what happens? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this doesn't go unnoticed. تَقَرَّبْتُ. In fact, look what Allah gives. أَكْرَمُ الْأَكْرَمِينَ. He is the most generous of those who are generous. Allah says, when you come to Allah a hand span, تَقَرَّبْتُ. I will come near إِلَيْهِ towards him, ذِرَاعًا, by an arm's length. Whatever little you give to Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala returns it to you multifold, you know, in multiples. You give Allah qaleel, little, he gives you jazeel, you know, he gives you this amazing reward. So when the slave draws near to me by a handspan, I will draw close to him by an arm's length. وَإِذَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ, and when he draws near to me, ذِرَاعًا, by an arm's length, تَقَرَّبْتُ مِنْهُ, I will draw near to him, بَاعًا, to the measure of two arm's lengths. Subhanallah. And look at the last part. وَإِذَا أَتَانِي يَمْشِي, and when he comes to me, يَمْشِي, walking, أَتَيْتُهُ هَرْوَلَةً, I come to him running and rushing. Subhanallah. So we just need to continue to give that little bit. That consistent little bit gets us so much in the long run. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability, you know, to make those changes that we need to make in order for us to fall part of this hadith and of the categories of these types of people who give up things for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you give up something for the sake of Allah, even if that thing is beloved to you, if that is not good for you and you give that thing up, imagine what Allah gives you in return. Subhanallah, it's unimaginable. Okay, hadith number 3, عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما. ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال, said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, نعمتان, there are two favors, there are two gifts, مغبون فيهما. Malbunun, it means that when you sell something for less than the amount that you could have actually sold it for, basically when you make a loss. So malbunun, are at a loss, fihima, regarding the two of them. So the hadith says there are two favors, there are two gifts, are at a loss regarding these two gifts. Who's at a loss? Kathirun minan nas, most of people, many, many people. Most people are at a loss regarding these two things. What are these two things? As-sihhatu, number one. As-sihha, health. Wal-faraag, and free time. Subhanallah. And again, you know, this the hadith comes with this imagery of a sale and of a trader. And if we look at that, it is basically the message is that siha and faragh, these two important things, health and free time, this is like our capital in our dealings, in our ventures. Now, you know that your profits can only do well if you actually manage your capital investment properly. And the hadith is saying, if you deal with that siha and that faragh with your capital in a good manner, and you actually work with it, you will then profit. You know, the profits will be endless, because that's basically how you receive profits, how you receive your rewards. But if you are completely negligent with regards to that capital, then you obviously are not going to make many profits. Wa na'udhu billah. And if you look at this hadith, it explains to us the quality of a believer, or what a believer should have, and that is that he is one who doesn't waste his time. Firstly, he's very, 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 very stingy with regards to his time, because he knows that that's the capital in which he deals with in this life. One moment gone is a moment closer to death. Wa na'udhu billah. And also for siha, health, you know, it's something that is often neglected, is how to look after your body, because we don't realize that that's the beginning of the shutdown, you know, of the self often. Because once your body gives in, and once your body is no longer able to do what it used to do, then obviously everything changes. Obviously, spirituality is not bound by the health of your physical body, but it does have a great impact on the amount of things you are able to do, on your energy levels, on your ibadah even. So it's really an, you know, it's a wake-up call for us to really be diligent with regards to the usage of our time, and also with regards to our bodies. What do we feed our bodies with? How do we treat our bodies? Are we paying attention to our health? And may Allah grant us the understanding. I mean, hadith number 4. Bismillah. عن عائشة رضي الله عنها عائشة رضي الله عنها narrates أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يقوم من الليل. He used to stand up at night. He used to stand up at night for what? For prayer. حتى until تتفطر قدماه, until his قدماه, his two feet تتفطر became cracked. Subhanallah. Because of the length and the duration of the time that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam stood up in this communication with his Rabb. فقلت له, so I said to him, لما تصنع هذا يا رسول الله؟ لما, why تصنع هذا؟ Why do you do this يا رسول الله, O messenger of Allah؟ وقد غفر الله لك, whilst indeed Allah has forgiven you ما تقدم, whatever has preceded من ذنبك, of your mistakes, وما تأخر, and that which has not yet come, you know, that which will still come. You basically your past mistakes and your future mistakes. And then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and remember over here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, well, the Prophets as a whole, they were completely free of sin. So this is the case where, you know, the saying goes, hasanatul abrar, sayyatul muqarrabin, that the hasanat, the good deeds of the abrar, of the righteous, for example, just look at making salah 5 times a day, it's a good deed, right? The good deeds of the righteous are equivalent to sayyatul muqarrabin, to the bad deeds of the muqarrabin, of those who are completely close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, the things that you and I do, if one who was really close to Allah only did those things, it would be as if he were committing something bad because of his high rank in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes and the fact that he gives his all. You know, it's not enough for him to just do his obligations. Subhanallah. So when we say dhamb for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are not even sins at all. They are minor indiscretions, little mistakes, you know, things that we wouldn't even consider to be something wrong. Well, anyway, so she asks the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah has forgiven you your past and your future sins, so why do you do this, ya Rasulullah? And he sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, afala uhibbu, so do I not like, do I not love, an akuna, that I be abdan shakura, that I be a abd, a slave who is shakur, a grateful slave. Should I then not be a grateful slave for this immense favor? And if we look at this, it reminds us of one of the most foundational lessons we could ever learn in our lives or teach our children, and that is of gratitude. Just be grateful for whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places in your path. Be grateful. Show your gratitude to Allah by worshipping Him in the best of your ability, by using the gifts He has given you to actually please Him. May Allah grant us this ability. We move to hadith number 5. Bismillah, عن عائشة رضي الله عنها. عائشة again narrates, أنها قالت, that she said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to, إذا دخل العشر, when دخل, when entered, when what entered, العشر, the 10, basically the last 10 nights of Ramadan it's talking about, we just passed these beautiful nights, when the last 10 nights of Ramadan entered, then what, أحيى الليلة, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would enliven al-layl, the nights, you know, he would stay up during the night praying. Wa ayqadha ahlahu, and not only him, he was not only just a man who lived for himself, ayqadha, and he used to wake up ahlahu, his family, he used to assist them in performing good deeds. He took and he assumed his role as the leader in that house. Ayqadha ahlahu, he woke up his family. Wajadda, and he would strive. Washadda, and he would tighten al-mi'zara, the waist belt. You know, the waist belt that they wore over there, almost like we know a lungi in Cape Town. So basically, they used to have a belt that used to hold everything in place. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, here we see that this expression is used. Shadda al-mi'zar, he used to tighten the waist belt. What does this mean? Well, they say there are two meanings. It could firstly be just a, an indication that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to distance himself from his wives during those last 10 days. But also the expression of tightening the waist belt, it means that someone is really, is really striving, is really going to the full lengths to achieve something good. And over here, it refers to ibadah. You know, like when we have a saying and we say, let's buckle down, let's do this thing. Basically, that's what the expression would then convey. That of seriousness, that of earnestness. So, Shadd al-Mi'zar, he used to tighten his waist belt. He expressed seriousness about ibadah in these last 10 days. And that shows us as well that when there are certain times that approach and we need to actually exercise some seriousness and some discipline, that we must rein ourselves in and we must make the most of those times because they pass. Those 10 days are long gone already. You know, the 6 days of Shawwal, we still have an opportunity for that, but that's going to pass too. So when those times of seriousness sets in, then we also need to behave in that manner, inshallah. And we also need to take our families along with us in a gentle manner. Okay, and then the last hadith of the chapter, Bismillah, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه. أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه narrates أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, that the Prophet of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, حجبت النار. حجبة, like the word hijab, right? Something that veils you, something that covers you, something that surrounds you. حجبت النار. So the hellfire is surrounded بالشهوات, by desires, by passions. We'll explain in a moment. وحجبت الجنة, and paradise, the garden of Jannah, it is surrounded بالمكاره, with disliked things. Subhanallah. So the fire is surrounded by desires, right? وَحُجِبَتِ الْجَنَّةِ, but Jannah is surrounded by things that are difficult, by things that could be disliked. What does that mean? The one scholar mentioned that you can't get to something that is veiled unless you cross the veil. Subhanallah. And Jannah and Jahannam are both covered in a veil. The veil that covers Jannah is all of the obstacles and all of the difficulties that you need to face in actually attaining that sweetness in the middle of that circle. So you need to walk through those things. You know, you need to walk through those tough times. You need to really, you know, get yourself together. You need to pull yourself together in order to get to Jannah, which is underneath that veil. You need to lift that veil. You need to cross that barrier. And Jahannam is again surrounded by things that are sweet, you know, it looks nice. It's those things that destroy your soul, those things that pull you in deeper, you know, so it's almost like a magnet that pulls you towards it. And we have a lower self, and the lower self is obviously attracted to these things. But we don't realize sometimes is that when you lift that veil, that pulls you deeper and deeper into Jahannam. Subhanallah. So you have to walk through these obstacles to get to Jannah. Little by little, we need to make ourselves stronger. We need to basically inoculate ourselves against, you know, all of the difficulties that we face. And the beautiful thing about these obstacles is that as we draw closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the obstacles don't disappear, but we become better equipped to deal with those things such that we are able to actually navigate that path. And the same thing with, you know, with all of the shahawat that surrounds Jahannam. If we also inoculate ourselves against those things and we realize and we use our aql and we realize that there are fleeting pleasures, you know, that's just a temporary gain. It's just that instant gratification for that moment, but there's nothing more that you get out of that. We soon realize that that is the path that we don't want to walk on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this beautiful hadith offers us this reminder, you know, look carefully, think and scrutinize your actions. Don't just go for what appears to be gold. All that glitters is definitely not gold. And inside of us, we know what is good for our soul. We know because our soul is attracted to beauty, to goodness. We make dua that Allah grants us the ability to firmly and with courage and with bravery to walk this path to Jannah, and also to neglect and to, you know, to neglect to be caught up in all of the trappings of this dunya. Ameen. Ya Rabbal Alameen. We'll end off there, inshaAllah. Recite our dua together. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.